Hi, my name is Dr. Padilla. I am a faculty member in computer science and psychology, and I have been a professor for over 5 years. I wanted to talk to you today about a topic that many undergraduate students have been asking me, and it's how to get into graduate school. You might be in a situation where you don't have any family members who have been to graduate school, and you don't have anyone to ask. So rest assured, I am going to give you the top 5 ways that you can get into graduate school. The first thing that you can do to get into graduate school is to contact the professor that you would like to work with in advance. You might not know this, and I've talked about this in previous videos, but unlike undergraduate programs where you apply to the program or even just the school, for graduate, specifically PhD programs, you apply to work with a specific advisor. That is very different. And because of that, you need to know a little bit about the advisor and get some one-on-one experience. Because truly what happens in the back end is we get thousands of applicants every year, and the individual advisors that the students indicate on their applications will go through and look at the applicants and select the ones that they are most interested in interviewing. So you want to be the person on the list that is interviewed by those advisors. So there are many ways to do that, and that leads to my second major tip, which is to contact the advisor that you want to work with in advance. And this can take many different forms. The more contact, the better, truly. We actually know from psychology that people have positive associations with people for whom they have seen more frequently. If it's easier to retrieve your name and your, you know, face from memory, people will have positive associations with you. So what you want to do is to be as memorable as possible to an advisor. That usually takes a form of emailing an advisor before you're applying, sometimes long before you're applying, to let them know that you're considering applying, to ask them if they're accepting students. You don't know if they're accepting students at that time, and to build a little bit of a rapport. Now, I'm going to have a whole video on how to do this particular process because it's quite subtle, and there's been kind of a surge of people doing it incorrectly and sort of spamming professors. So you don't want to be in that group of people. You want to be in the group that is more likely to get a email back from the advisor. But in any case, the goal is to contact the advisor in advance, get to know them as much as you can personally, to have them select your application out of the bunch. Like I said, you could do that with an email to the professor. You can also do that by seeing them at a conference. This is really a pro tip that I encourage all students to do. So if there is someone that you're interested in applying to work with, go find a conference in which they are presenting a paper or some type of scholarly presentation. You can go and watch them present so you can get a sense of how they are interpersonally, and it gives you an opportunity to ask them questions after. You can line up to ask people questions after their talk if you have a particularly good one, or you can also find them at the coffee breaks in between the different sessions. And that is really where the best networking happens, in part because everyone is feeling sort of awkward and they're not sure what to do. And if they're not, you know, swarmed with people that they're talking to, they might be just as uncomfortable as you are and want to talk to someone. So that is a great opportunity if you see the person that you would like to potentially work with at a conference, particularly getting coffee, and they're not talking to anyone, walk up to them and say, you know, I just read your paper and I thought it was fantastic. I have some ideas or thoughts that I'd love to talk to you about. You can say, I just watched your talk. I have some, you know, interesting things that we'd like to discuss. The more of this interpersonal connection you can make with someone that you are applying to work with, the better. Now, I know this might seem like a lot of work, because what students tend to do is apply to 20, 30 different places. And I encourage you to not do this. I encourage you to just apply specifically to targeted places for which you are among the best applicants. There's many things you can do to make yourself a great applicant that I'll talk about in various videos, but making sure that you're not just spamming, casting a wide net, but using your time and energy to form sincere relationships, to deeply care about someone's research, that will pay off 10 times more than sending out hundreds of different applications, and it will save you money too. So tip 3 for getting into graduate school is to be very strategic in where you apply. I suggest that you apply to places, and particularly with advisors, that have research that very, very closely aligns with the type of research you've done in the past. What can happen is you can get, and this happens to me every year, frankly, I get dozens of fantastic students on paper. They're really excellent, but they don't study what I study, and they have no background in what I do, and they don't know about my research. And you might think, well, graduate school is an opportunity to learn. It's an educational experience, which is true. However, you want to learn some things, but not everything. Think about it more like a job where there's lots of on-the-job training. You can't show up to that job and have zero skills. You need some relevant skills, and then you can learn other things. So what you want to do is apply specifically to programs where you have a good set of baseline skills, and then you can add on top of that with whatever additional type of methods or research that advisor is doing. So it's not at all successful to email dozens of professors and list a bunch of skills that you have that are unrelated to the work that they do. If you strategically pick places to apply to and say, here is my specific skills that will be useful to you, that is really the ticket. And you know, if you really wanted to maximize your chances, so what you really want to do is look at the most recent work that the lab is doing and see if you have skills that can benefit that particular research trajectory, because you want to be seen as this person who brings all of these assets with you that can really advance the research program of a particular lab or group, and target those places for which you have skills. And it might seem like, you know, you don't have relevant skills. For example, I have a very diverse background. I have a master's degree in art and a master's degree in psychology and a PhD in cognitive neuroscience. And now I'm in a computer science department. Okay. But what I bring is a strong background in understanding how the mind functions. And I use that to develop computational techniques to visualize data in a way that aligns with human reasoning. That is a strange union of things. I bring to a computer science department a deep understanding of how the mind processes information, which can help us build better programs. So that was a way where I brought something new to a group that didn't have that type of expertise. So that's what you want to do. Find your skill set and utilize that to really be an asset to the lab. And that will help you rise above the other people in terms of applications. And when you are talking with advisors and when you're writing up your documents, you want to highlight that and say, here's my base skill. I'm looking forward to contributing this new skill or this new expertise to the group. And I think it could help the group advance in this way. And I'm also excited to learn this other element that the professor or the lab or the program is adding. That is a perfect combination of things. You're bringing something new and you're learning something important as well. That strategy is a winning combination to get into a PhD program. Tip 4 for getting into a PhD program is to think about alternative funding mechanisms. So funding is a tricky topic, and I'm going to do a whole video just on funding for PhD programs. But the way that this works is that for most scientific disciplines, an advisor will put up money for your salary and for part of your tuition. This means that they have a limited amount of money that they can allocate to students. The way they actually get this money is they write these big grants and spend all their time writing and managing grants. So they've worked really hard to get this special pot of funds to essentially hire PhD students. So what you want essentially to do is be the best possible applicant for that limited pool of money that they would be willing to dedicate to you for 5 years. Now, you might not be the best applicant. I don't think I was necessarily the best applicant when I applied, but what you can do is think about alternative funding sources. Oftentimes, the limiting factor for a faculty member accepting you into the program is that they just do not have enough money, or the program doesn't have enough money to accept the 10th or 12th student. So you can consider things like writing grants. There is a grant mechanism called an NSF GRFP. It's a graduate fellowship, and most students wait until their first or second year in a graduate program to apply. Pro tip, you get an extra chance to apply if you apply before you get into a program. So generally, when students apply to the NSF GRFP, they get one chance during their PhD career. If you apply before you get in, you get 2 chances. And if you come in bringing money, then a lot more places will be willing to accept you, because it's always you're paying for yourself. So it's really a win-win for everyone. Now, you might be wondering, how the heck do I write in grant if I'm not even in a PhD program? That can actually be quite challenging, but it is a really good inroad to meeting and working with a particular professor that you're interested in. What you can do is propose an idea that you want to do in the lab that is generally an extension of the work they're currently doing, and propose that you want to write it for an NSF GRFP prior to admission into the program, and they will work with you on that application. Applications are relatively short. It might seem long for you, you know, if you've never written one of these, but in the long scheme of things, they're relatively short. So that is an example of an alternative funding mechanism where you come in with your own funds, and that will open up a lot of schools to be willing to accept you into their PhD programs. And my final tip five for getting into graduate school is really a kind of a general umbrella tip, which is to de-risk yourself. As I've talked about throughout this video, oftentimes the reason that you don't get into particular programs is that they just don't have the funds for you, because an advisor has to do lots of work to secure funds. And so they want to allocate it on a sure thing. So tip five is to de-risk yourself. This means that there's lots of different risks associated with a graduate student. You may be applying to a program and you haven't done that particular line of research before, and you may hate it. You truly might not like that research and it might not fit for you. You don't know. You haven't done that before. That is a risk. So how do you de-risk yourself? You can do things like volunteer in the lab that you're applying to work with. Then you can see if you truly like that work, and you can see if the advisor-advisee relationship works well for you. That is a very important one as well. Not everyone works well together. What will make or break your PhD career is your connection with your advisor. And I have no secret formula for how to make that work. The students that work well for me are different than the students that work well for someone else. It is truly a mystery how it comes to be, but there is clearly a case when you click with an advisor and when you don't. So a way to de-risk yourself is to determine if you work well with that individual in advance. That's doing things like collaborating with them, volunteering in their lab, asking them to be an advisor on your thesis project if you're in undergrad. I've done that with several people, and that works out really, really well. It gives us an extended opportunity to determine if we like working with each other, if I can give feedback in a way that is useful for the student, etc. That is very, very useful. So that is an important element of de-risking yourself, is just the interpersonal connection. Another de-risking thing you might consider doing is taking some additional classes to be prepared for a particular program. Oftentimes, very technical programs require a great deal of background knowledge, and to get up and running in those programs can be really challenging. So you might consider taking an additional course to demonstrate that you have the chops to make it in that particular PhD program. It's just another level of de-risking yourself. And that absolutely applies if you're moving from one field to another. You might have gotten your undergraduate degree in biology and want to switch over to chemistry for your PhD. That's a big risk. To de-risk yourself, you need to demonstrate that you can be successful in a program. So what you can do, of course, is to take some additional classes, even if they're voluntary, to demonstrate that you can de-risk yourself. And the last one in terms of de-risking is more of a interpersonal social situation, where the more you can get one-on-one FaceTime with a potential advisor, the more that de-risks you. Because the truth is that we get hundreds of applicants, and it is a distribution of people who apply. And you hope that you get applicants who are great and nice and excited, but you do get some people at the tail ends of the distribution who are a little crazy. And we can't tell. When someone sends in a resume, you can't tell if they're crazy or not, or, you know, if they will have problems that will really affect their PhD career. So a way to de-risk yourself just interpersonally is meeting an advisor. And what students tend to do, which is really hard, is they ask for one-on-one meetings in a cold email. If I was to have a one-on-one meeting with every person who emailed me, I would spend 200 hours on these meetings. It is just truly impossible. So if you can find other low-stakes ways to get FaceTime with potential advisor and meet them in a way that's not costing them a lot of time and energy, you will sincerely increase your chances of getting into that program, because they meet you, they know you're nice, they know you're not a wild card, and that is really a major step in making it through the process. So I hope these five tips for getting into graduate school were helpful. There are many more things I could say about getting into graduate school. These were really the five that I think people know about the least, and that I think will increase your chances of getting into graduate school the most. If you're interested in more content about being successful in academia, please like this video and comment for any other topics you would like for me to cover. The truth is that I didn't have someone who helped me through the PhD program and applying as much as I would have liked to. So if I can be that person for you, I'm happy to do that. Take care.